It's a privilege to be here. Thank you to the AsiaVR team and Jiang Kuo and Roy and to organize this, because it's probably my first official visit back and having a session here in Singapore after being away for so long. So it's awesome to be back here. So just for clarification, I'm actually from Singapore. I've just been in China for the past 11 years. It's my professional career. So before I set this up, I was running Unity China. Actually, I was employee number one. I helped set up Unity in China and Taiwan and Hong Kong. So that was in 2011. And before that, I spent 12 years in Microsoft. And so it has been always been a technology field for a long time. Saw the rise of PC and with. In 2011, I saw that 3D content is going to make a difference in what we do. So that was when I jumped in and joined Unity, and you know, through the trend. When I first joined Unity, we had about 10,000 developers in China on developing 3D. In the last 4 or 5 years, now it's probably close to 1 million people developing 3D, using Unity alone. So it has been phenomenal. When I first met with, I think I came in contact with VR, of course, when I was in the IBM days, I saw, you know, the big machine, put a head in, the virtual reality space. It's only a few years ago when Pamalaki, from the founder for Oculus, came to us, actually. At the time, he hadn't been acquired by Facebook yet. He made this machine, and he needed content. All hardware manufacturers need content, right? So he came to us and said, can I have some content running on Unity? And so we actually ported a few contents to Oculus. And of course, 6 months later, he was acquired by Facebook. And the rest is history. So that's why we're here. So when I first saw that a few years ago, I saw the trend of virtual reality. So to Jiahen's point, why do I vote with my feet and be in this field full-time? Because for a few things. One, it's if you see the technology trend over the last 20, 30 years, you know, Microsoft took about 30 over years to get PC on every desktop. And it took them 30 plus years. Now it has reached close to, 6 billion people? Is it 4 to 5 billion across the world? And iPhone alone, does anybody know how long has iPhone 1 been around since now? There you go. So it has only been about 10 years. So can you imagine from the era iPhone 1 till now has only been 10 years. So it took smartphone 10 years to be as pervasive as what it is today. So every generation, so for me, being a technology field, I've always been asking myself, what is the next screen? Because the next screen factor, it's going to determine how contents evolved and how we build contents around that screen. And so when I saw virtual reality, I saw Oculus being acquired, I said, hey, this might be the next big thing. And so I've tracked it for quite some time. And so last year, I finally left my professional career and I set up this company called UCCVR. It stands for Ultimate Creators Create Virtual Reality, in short. Well, we're terrible at branding, so in short. So UCCVR, and I set up in Shanghai, because I've been in Shanghai 4 years, Beijing, before that Beijing 7 years, partly because a few factors. Number one, if you look at what's happening in the valley, the Silicon Valley, well, majority of the reason why Silicon Valley was big in the IT tech era was really because, you know, the history that Silicon Valley had, right? You have the Cisco, you have the HP, you have the IBM, they had the talent that accumulated in Silicon Valley. And then, of course, you have the money. Because for every new industries to happen, I think there has to be 4 things to happen before a new industry will take place. Number one, you need great ideas. So all of you here belongs to that category, right? We all have great ideas. And the fact that you're here means that you're interested in this new thing. So ideas is the first thing. The second of all, you need people. You need talents to commit themselves to the idea. And so people like everyone here who has been going full-time, started a business, entrepreneur, or you join a big company, and then you are in this era. So that's talent. The third thing talent needs to be sustainable, it's money. So that's the realistic side of the question, right? You can have dreams, but if you don't have funding, then your ideas and your time will not be fully utilized. And so industry needs investments to especially kickstart a new industry. The last thing an industry needs is a business model. Because as an investor, the investor can give you enough funding for 1 year, 2 years, and probably that's it. If you can't find your business model after X number of years, it's very difficult for the investment community to continue funding you for the long term. So it's important, any new technology, you have to find a new business model for this thing to take off. And so along that line, I reckon if I were to participate in this industry, it makes sense for me to do a few things. One, I set up a community, so I bring people together. This community, this is a great community in Singapore, and you guys should be awesome, awfully proud of yourself. The second thing is investments. So all community needs investments. And the reason why, the second story I tell is, accidental reason why I'm here is because Vito, Chiang Kuo, took part in our games competition last year. I ran a nationwide competition in China, and his team took part, won some awards, and so we invested in them. So we are the early stage investor in Vito. And so because of that, I decided to come back and say, hey, talents exist everywhere. Talent exists in US, talent exists in the West, talent exists in the East. So talent exists everywhere. But the question is that the right talent has to be matched with the right dollars, has to be matched with the right ideas, and has to be matched with the right market. And that's the reason why I've been trying it for 11 years, because it has the right market, at least in my view, a big enough market to sustain new ideas, to try new ideas. And so the whole gist of today's conversation, it's about a few things. So a few things of what I've seen in the world. I think UCCVR is probably one of the most aggressive. If you look at US, you have the river, you have a few people. And then in China, there's a few investment funds that's been pretty aggressive, focusing on this space as well. UCCVR is probably one of the most aggressive there as well. Because a big reason is because I've seen this community literally grew up from a few years ago. So just to share with you some of the thinking and observation that I've seen. So content-wise, give you some numbers. And I have intentionally taken numbers from different sources. Now, if you are a true MI person, a market intelligence person, you would know, hey, never take numbers from different places because you'll never add up. But I've intentionally take numbers from different places just to give you a sense across all the analysts in the world, how they view this market. So Chiao-Hun gave you a good overview from what he thinks in terms of contents, but in terms of the overall big market, the investment bankers out there, the investment guys out there, where do they see the money and where do they see the numbers? So just to share you with a few numbers. So don't take the numbers and try to triangulate them. It doesn't add up because it's from different sources, but just to give you a sense, a glimpse of how the analysts in the world are looking at this opportunity. Hardware projection. Like I said, any industry to take off, you've got to first have, if there was no iPhone, there wouldn't be an Angry Bird that would be as successful. Right? You need the iPhone needs an Angry Bird, just like a 3D theater needs an avatar. So a good hardware will always need a good content, and then you have your platform players. So it's a certain projection that you need to go with in the industry. And of course, just to share with you some glimpse from the trenches, right? What does it look like in China right now? And of course, a bit of explanation about what we do. So if you have any questions, feel free to raise your hands and just feel free to shout. If I'm slow with some numbers conversion because my calculator doesn't work as fast, I'm translating between Chinese numbers and English numbers. So between millions and the Chinese denominators. So if you look at the whole overall projection, as a market, for an industry to feed itself, for an industry to sustain the talent pool that's coming into the industry, it has to have sufficient big enough space. And so this number is from Goldman Sachs. And so if you look at the numbers, baseline case, the best case, or rather the base case itself, they are looking at about $70 billion market. So it's interesting, $70 billion US dollars market, and that's $80 billion US market. So 45 hardware and 35 software, and that's the base case. So the best case could be 182, the worst case could be a lot lower. So what is interesting here is that if you look at a trend, the numbers varies quite a lot, right? Because usually when you say best case and worst case, Singapore GDP, when you predict GDP, you say, hey, best case 0.3, worst case, best case 0.5, worst case 0.2. So you don't have that much difference. Here's a big delta. What does it show you? It shows you that, no one knows better, right? No one knows better. Everybody is guessing, right? But from a technology's point of view, you go in because you think it has some leeway. From a business point of view, you go in because you think, oh, maybe out of the technology, some business model will evolve. But regardless, whatever path that you choose for yourself, either a professional career or entrepreneurship, it's critical for you to think about what you want to do and what space are you most passionate about. But in any case, just keep in mind, about 80 billion is what Goldman Sachs is saying. The other thing is that if you look at the growth projection from the CAGR means year on year over X number of years, 2025, the average CAGR is 50%. So that's good. Worldwide, 50% growth worldwide. So that's the projection of what Goldman Sachs is thinking about. So just keep that in mind. The second thing is, when you look at the market, it's, you know, there is a lot of conversation about VR, AR, and MR. Or, you know, there are other terms I've seen as well, but overall, those are three big words that came out: VR, AR, and MR. So just out of curiosity in this room, how many of you have tried with a goggle? I mean, a HMD. How many have tried a HMD? Thank you. How many have not tried a HMD? Cool. So there's a few of you. So my number one thing is, if you have not tried, get out there and try one, right? HTC, it's an example of a PC base. A Samsung Gear, it's an example of a mobile base, right? And then you have others, AR devices as well. What was most encouraging for me was, I'm back from my summer holidays, right? And I was in a family dinner 2 nights ago. And guess what? My cousin, who is like 19 years old, going to army this year, actually has a Samsung Gear VR. And I was very encouraged, because to see a gear landing in the hands of a consumer means that we are one step closer to the market. But what is critical here is, this is probably too small for you. We can share this online later if you want to. But you can see some of the devices that's out there. By the way, this is from Keza in 2015. So what is really fascinating is that in the last 1 year, the number of hardware devices that came out is a lot. If you go there, you look at Pho from Japan, you look at, you name it. I'll share with you a lot from China later as well. They call China the Hua Changpei. It's the Shenzhen, where it's a big cloning machine going on. So there's a lot of hardware coming out from China too. And so some of the numbers will kind of shock you. It shocked me when I first saw the numbers. But the cool thing is to see the number of innovation, because everyone is innovating. Because when a technology, it's not stable. That means not so much stable is not the right word, but if it's not mature, so there will be a lot of people trying different stuff. And so everybody's trying to put things together, some with AR, some with VR, and it's really cool to see the innovation. To a late stage investor, a big guy like Temasek, for example, they'll say, hey, this is too early, I don't see the model. But there are a lot of early stage guys as well that can help you along your way. Now, the next thing is VR, AR. So, you know, a lot of people say, hey, what is, you know, how do you see virtual and AR? My view is AR will be bigger than VR, because it's very hard to be locked into an environment and not be aware of your external environment for a very long time. Plus, the comfort feeling of a headset right now is not that great. So I think AR will take on hold and be in a big way. But for AR to really take hold, it requires two main things. One, it requires a very good HMD, right? Because for us to put a thing over HoloLens is a great try, but it's really not the best experience. And it's way too expensive, right? So AR needs to have a good glass that have a wide, good enough view. So one thing is a headset. So I feel like VR, the cost of a VR headset will be lower than the AR, because, you know, when you close everything up versus you open everything up and motion capture everything around you, the cost of an AR headset inevitably will be higher than a VR headset. Make sense? It's just more components put in there. So I think AR headsets will be a 2.0 of the VR headsets manufacturers. So if I'm a VR manufacturer, I get my market share, I do a next release product update, and it becomes an AR device, perhaps that's a better, that means my channel has been built, my consumers, my customers has been built as well. So I think AR headsets will require some time before the AR, to sort of use the VR headsets to get market the consumer share before you introduce an AR headset. So that's one thing, headsets. And number two, for AR to take hold, today AR, it's really just, well, Pokemon Go is a classic example, it's a game, right? But it's not, you won't be connected to the game forever, right? It's just a game experience. Just like you watch Avatar, you won't watch Avatar 10,000 times. So it's, whereas the rest of AR experiences are all in B2B, so business to business. Today I sell my services to a customer, and I use that as a new medium to integrate the experience. So, but for AR to really take hold in like a consumer lifestyle, it will be something like Google Maps. So you require one company, one rich enough company, to go around scanning everything else before when I look at you, I get a profile and data from you. Right? So that makes sense, right? Because for AR to really integrate, when I put on my glasses, I need to know who you are. So that flag or that ID is super critical. So I personally think my sense is the face will become the ID. You know, in China we have the WeChat, the right RFID. It's a WeChat. I think the face will be the next identifier. So that when I look at you, and if I'm Google and I've scanned enough data around of everyone, and I capture all information on the web, when I look at you, I can integrate your data, and that's AR to me. So I think that before that day comes, I think VR will have its place in the market. And then as it evolves, you have more and more things coming into the market as well. So that's my view. Could be wrong, could be right, but it's anyone's guess. So let's look at, so a lot of content developers ask me, right? So if I am a content developer, first, if I'm Angry Bird, I got to make sure that number one, I choose the right platform. If Angry Bird says, no, I'm not going to do an iPhone, I do something else, Angry Bird would have missed the chance to get an iPhone. So the platform that you choose is also very, very important. So just to give you a background across some of the platforms that I see, so Oculus and HTC will be cool and great. HTC have a full motion to a B2B space, it's great, but to a B2C space, it's going very hard, especially in Asia. Most of us don't have big houses, right? We don't leave the Hollywood waves, we don't have a big house. It's very hard for me to have two devices. Even if you give me a HTC today, it's very hard for me to connect it in my house. So it's going to be a challenge. So I think HTC and Oculus will have its place. I think at least in HTC that I've seen so far, it's very much in the B2B space. So if I'm in a B2B and I'm trying to get a project from some big customer, for example, a property developer, and I put in a HTC configuration with a high-end PC, that's fine. But if I start selling in, say, the Walmarts of the world, it's going to be very, very tough. So when I look at HTC and Oculus, I think it's clearly positioned. It's one, of course, HTC sells to the Steam gamers as well, but I'm just saying that the volume would not be that great. PSVR worldwide, it's clearly, I think, we are partnering very closely with Sony, especially for the China launch, and the numbers I've seen so far has been optimistic. Now, for a user to already have PS4 to pay another $399 to buy over Christmas season as a gift, I think that's a valid business model. I do not need to buy a $4,000 machine in order to buy a HMD. So just an upgrade. And the Sony executive in the worldwide thinks the same way too. So the way they position PSVR is really like a peripheral. So just like gear, it's a peripheral. If Samsung today, the cost of the Samsung Gear VR, it's in a range of probably $25, $30. So I'm talking about the cost of the BOM, the bill of materials. And the Chinese manufacturers have come to me and says it's going to be $15. Well, some of the manufacturers I've seen has got it down to $15. So a $15 BOM, it makes it easier to get it into a smartphone devices. And that's come to my next slide. If you look at the mobile, it is going to make a huge difference. Everyone, and I'm saying everyone, every cell phone manufacturer in the world that I've spoken to have already planned a VR headsets. There's not a single one that I know of that doesn't have a VR plan in the pipeline, right? So if you look at the shipments numbers out there in the world, Apple is one. And I think I have a conspiracy theory that says Apple is not going to VR because it's their way of differentiating against their competitors. Why do I say that? Because Apple, if you look at the price, the price sensitivity of Apple is not as high. Apple and Samsung is one category versus the rest of the guys. Make sense? So if I'm Apple today, Samsung already has a gear. If I start introducing increased costs into my bump, if I can continue to keep my costs down, it actually forces all the other operators who was trying to go to VR to lose more money. Because if you think about Samsung in a gear, they have been giving out gear as part of the promotions together with the Galaxy S6 and S7 series. So, it's a price sensitivity out there as well. It's really not hard to get a VR experience. I have this device from Shenzhen, one of the team that I looked at. So, for example, this is an Apple device, and it's really just a cradle, and you can turn it into a VR glass straight away. Right? It's not a fantastic experience. It's a at least a 10-15 minutes experience. It's fine. I can hold it and I can become a VR. So everybody that has an iPhone case can be a VR. Simple 360 sort of a experience as well. So it opens up a different market altogether. Now, technology opens up a different market. Business model, you've got to think about it, right? Because the business model for PSVR and Steam and Oculus Store, it's very valid. I put something online, I download it, I charge as a premium title. That makes a lot of sense. In the mobile space, especially on Android, it's a different animal altogether. Very few people makes that much revenue off a premium titles in an Android environment. So the business model is something we can talk about later, but from a devices support point of view, my recommendations to most of the teams that I invested in, it's number one, support PSVR, because I think they could have more shipments than we think. Number two, supports at least gear as a standard. And so if you use S7 or S6 as the gear as the basis, every hardware manufacturer is going to bump up. From what I've gathered so far, at least 40% of all manufacturers, branded manufacturers, would support Snapdragon 820 after end of the year. So, and plus Daydream is really a standard out there. So you will have a lot more VR-ready handsets come end of the year. So that would be a big thing to look out for come end of the year. So if you're developing something, my suggestion is stay as S7 as a standard or S6 as a standard and then move up to PSVR if you want to do dual platform support. And when you're developing on PSVR, keep this in mind. A lot of people don't realize this. They happily develop, they go to Symbian Square, they buy the best machine, and then they bring it home and they start coding. They work everything on HTC, and then when they need to port to PSVR, they have a huge headache. Because PS4, technical specs, it's only a fraction of the machine out there. So when you're developing on PSVR, my suggestion is that make sure your development machines don't buy the 1080, the latest machine graphics card, and then in the end, you spend a lot of time migrating downwards to support, right? It's not hard to develop the coolest and latest and the most cinematic experience, but it's really, really a test of your technical knowledge when you need to support the lower-end devices like the smartphones and the PSVR. So test yourself on that. Just be conscious of what you are developing and the platform that you're supporting as well. That's critical because that will save you at least 3 to 6 months of development life cycle. Now, we've spoken about hardware, we've spoken about the trend. Let's talk about software. Now, when you look at so video games is clearly the big thing, right? Because if you look at 3D cinemas, before Avatar came out, everybody was talking about 3D cinemas, but nothing really took off until Avatar came along. iPhone was the same, right? I still remember the conversations between iPhone versus BlackBerry. Do you remember RIM? Right? A long time ago, there used to be a company called RIM. So can you imagine? Everybody was saying quirky key versus a touchpad, and this is no longer a conversation today. And that only took, 5 years? So my point is, a lot of your friends will tell you, oh, VR is going to take a long time, it's going to come long later. They might be right, but then again, there's a chance that you might be right. Okay, so hold on to the hope and the belief that you might be right. And at the same time, if you are right, then what are you going to do? How do you become the angry bird on a new platform? So that's something to think about. So in the content space, video games is clearly one thing because entertainment helps get to the hands of consumers the quickest. Live events. So this is really interesting. I personally don't quite agree with the mix because it left out one thing. Porn. Huge. Let me tell you, it's huge. I've seen DMM, I've seen the companies because, and David Helgeson sits on the board of one of porn companies in Denmark. So it's huge. In fact, I forgot to tell you one number, which I didn't put up there because it's not an official number. But if you go to Symbian Square, I just saw this guy's called VR Box in Symbian Square selling for, I can't remember exactly how much he's selling for. But anyway, that cost, can you believe how much is that cost of that box device? And then it's a plastic version of a Google Cardboard, right? So it's like $4 Sing. Okay? $4 Sing, that's from Shenzhen. $4-$5 Sing. So can you imagine? And guess what? 3 companies from Shenzhen in the last 12 months, I'll say, 12 to 9 months, how many boxes do you think they have shipped out? 3 companies in Shenzhen. Make a guess of that plastic Google cardboard. Someone bring a guess. No price. I forgot to bring your t-shirts. It's for holiday. So, just shout a number.
3 million.
3 million. Anyone?
6 million.
6 million. Calling once. Calling twice.
10 million.
10 million. Okay. Three companies shipped out 10 million of those plastic box. They're selling for, I think, 140 RMB. So you divide by 6, you get a US dollars. Okay. So it's phenomenal. And up to this day, nobody knows where they go. I've asked everyone, where did they go? It's 10 million boxes. Where did they go? Well, at least I saw 5 in Sim Square. I think porn is a big thing. So I think a lot of things went to porn. So I have my personal values. I don't support porn industry. But I'm just saying from industry point of view, a lot of it is happening that way. Right? So is it a good thing? I don't know. But the key thing is that, so that market is also quite big as well. But you look at that industry, and you look at video games, you look at healthcare. I'm big on education. I mean, Sher is the chairman for HTC. She totally agrees with me as well. We think that VR in education is going to be huge. I have seen a demo when a teacher is teaching, and the students are all wearing glasses, and then the teacher can use the iPad to control what the students learn. I think education is a huge thing. And I think that in a new medium, if you look at PC, you look at iPads, you look at or tablets, and you look at the phone, where was the place where it was really broadly propagated? It's education. You look at Apple for the longest time, Apple Education Business Unit has been critical in propagating Apple technology for the longest time. And so I think education content is absolutely critical. So for those of you who are working, you have contacts, you have your aunt and uncle working in MOE, talk to them, get some traction in there, and start using some of these core contents to make a difference. I think education is huge. Real estate is very big in China. Now, I'll give you an example. This is a real example. For a real property developer, for example, if I am the Far East, I don't know about Singapore regulations, but in China, for example, if I'm the Far East in China, once I get a piece of land, for me to actually get a showcase out there and start getting a show flat, to start getting consumers into the show flat to pay me deposits, it takes me about 18 months or so. 18 months to apply for the permits, and China is a very complex place to get permits. And number two, it'll cost me about 20 million RMB, and you divide by 6 to get US dollars, to have a show flat ready for consumers to come in to give me their checks. So at least 18 to 24 months. But with the latest technology, VR, you guess what? You can create that content for 1/10 the price and at 1/10 the time. And you can go to market at a much quicker way. That's huge. That is when technology is going to make a difference. Because if technology is still in the hands of 200 of us, it will never be a big thing. But if it changes the rules of a vertical industry, it could be a huge thing. So I personally go, when I look at teams, I have a 1/10 principle. Whatever the team is doing, does it have the space to become, does it have the potential to become a 1/10 of the price and 1/10 of the time? If you do, then you will change the rule. That's how PC changed the rule on mainframe. That's how smartphone changed the rule on PC. It's exactly that. You have to be faster, quicker, and at a much lower cost. So huge conversation. Huge thing to think about. I think as a technology platform, think of it as a screen where all around you is your screen. Then there's really no limit to whatever industry you can cover. Literally every industry. It's just a matter of which industry starts first. Make sense? There's still some ministries today that doesn't use PC or the internet. Just kidding. It's a joke in Singapore, right? So, but you know, PC was a big thing and it took time for all the verticals to get online, to endorse internet in a big way. Well, in VR, I think of the same thing. So there'll be some industries that go first, but it does not mean that, you know, if visualization is the technology, and I call VR, AR a visualization technology, then it will have a potential to change a lot of things, how things are being done today. So just a quick note here. I looked at internet as a form of connection for the world, right? I still remember the days when I was doing a Unix machine. I have to go to every single machine and install a TCP/IP protocol. I don't know, some of you might be, if you tell me yes, then you are at the aged group as well. But I remember those days when we had to install a protocol to connect to the internet. So if internet is the protocol that engages and brings everybody together, the reason why I think VR would be great, because it would be the visualization, or VR AR would be the visualization layer that brings experience to the next level. So if you think along that trend, what sort of skill sets do you need yourself? What sort of skill sets do you need in your team to create, to leverage the connection that was already brought together by internet, at the same time to bring visualization to the next level, and to understand the industry enough to make a difference? So that's something for you to think about too. Okay, China. I first shared this slide, I think, about 3-4 years ago when I was going around with the Unity crew in Unite. And so I from then to now, a lot of people understood China a lot better. But for some of you who really have not really engaged Chinese customers in a big way, just to give you a quick background on Chinese economy. So overall, when you look at I personally don't look at China as a country. When I look at China, I always think of it as the EU of the East. Right? It is an EU of the East. There's like 30 over provinces. Jiang Kuo knows this better than I do, but you know, there's 30 over provinces in China, and everyone is a different GDP. Every city is so different. When I was in Beijing, I could clearly remember when I was in Beijing city itself, the metro city, you can feel the bustle and the hustle of a strong first-tier city. And then when you drive, say, 1 hour out, there is the farmland out there. So it's a big contrast. So when you build something, I remember Steve Ballmer, when he was a CEO for Microsoft, used to say this in front of all of us. When you think of China, never think of China as a single economy. Think of it as a market segments that you need to split up. So when you think of EU, for example, you don't think of EU as one country. Make sense? When you think of Germany, it's very different from the way you think of Lithuania. Very different, right? So that's the way you should think about when you think about China. China, it's an EU of the East. So when you think about, so along the coastal area, there's close to about 200 million people that you can target. If you look at the WeChat numbers, WeChat is a, we don't have Facebook. So a lot of people ask me, do you have Facebook? No. Other than if I do a firewall thing. WhatsApp is really slow. So if you want to talk to me, get yourself on WeChat, because that's the fastest way of communication for me. So it's I call it, so when you look at the WeChat numbers, in the eastern region at night, the eastern region people, right, the people along Shanghai, Hangzhou, you know, that's, is there a pointer here?
Yeah.
There's a pointer. Okay. So this area, so if you look at this area, the people at night, they are looking at videos, they are chatting on WeChat. You know, it's just like WhatsApp. If you look at people here, they're all playing games. And it's very clear. The numbers are very, very clear. I think, I can't remember the exact numbers, 60% are WeChatting and watching videos here, and then 60% are all playing games here. When I was in Unity, when I was driving mobile gaming in China, that year, we had 500 million RMB of revenue all up in the industry. Today, it's already at 6 billion, right? So 60% of revenue came from this region. So if you are building a game and you want to go free to play and you want to compete with the Chinese guys, don't build it for here, build it for here, right? The guys that's in at home, they don't have KTV, they don't have that many cinemas, they have no entertainment. And so the phone becomes their entertainment. And so a great game that's engaging, that is not, you know, you don't have, you know, so that's why when you design a content, be clear who you're designing for. The Uber point I'm driving here is, be very clear who you're designing for. So when somebody says, I want to go in China, and it says, I'm penetrated in Beijing and Shanghai, that's nothing. That's nothing at all, okay? So there's about 40 over tier one cities. So if you want to, we can talk more in details. I can go on for half an hour at least on this slide alone. So, but in any case, it's a different province. So when you want to build something, you want to do a business in China, think about where exactly you want to be in. Now let's talk about the numbers.
How about the area in the very west?
The very west. The very west, this place, Xinjiang and Tibet, we usually don't even cover that. Because the GDP is way too low. They're very religious. They don't really support, you know, technology. It's not that well accepted too. So, yeah. So just to give you a background, it's tough. I used to run a team of 150 people and we're all across China just trying to sell machines into each region. And the way you sell is very, very different too. So why am I excited about VR? Because I think for the first time, 30 years ago, Chinese doesn't have access to consoles. In fact, most of them don't even have access to PC and internet. And so if you look at what happened in the mobile era, China got an equal footing with the West. So today, the biggest gaming company is not Microsoft, it's no longer Microsoft, it is Tencent. It's amazing. It was unbelievable. I would not have believed you if you told me that 5 years ago. Tencent is the number one biggest gaming company by revenue in the world today. Microsoft is second, right? Ubisoft could be sold to the Chinese guys very soon. That's not a joke. Okay, so I've been involved in many. The reason why I base myself in China, because the money that is in China, it's amazing. Because I call it the three firewalls. The first firewall is what you heard of, is the Great Firewall of China, where you can't access Facebook and Twitter. The second firewall is the monetary currency firewall, where the RMB conversion is controlled, and so therefore they can have a very close economy and help boost, and they have a different ratings versus the PE levels, etc. A gaming company, if I list in NASDAQ, it's 5 times, 6 times, 7 times. If I listed in China, it could be 100 times. And so the artificial valuation helps them fund the overseas expansion. So it's a strategic level. The top level in China is really, really cool. I mean, it's super smart. And then the third firewall is the policies. Right? If you are content, you want to be a platform in content platform in China, you can't unless you have the Chinese passport. So I call it the three firewalls of China that helps ring fence it. There is some positivity of it, there is some negativity of it, but from a business point of view, it is positive in the sense that the investments that comes out. So that's why for us, for example, I raised capital in China, and part of it in China, part of it overseas, but majority in China, and then I invest overseas. So when we look at what's happening right now, in fact, in the last... You know, what's fascinating, last year, when I was talking to the guys, everybody, the best companies in the world, I'm talking about the best VR companies in the world. You can think about the top, I won't put names, but if you think about those companies that's the best in VR in their respective scenarios, by platform, by contents, by video, by hardware, almost all of them that I know have came to China, have looked for funding. I personally have vetted DD through most of the companies. So it's amazing. So because with the investments, like I said, ideas, people, and money, and so with the strength of the Chinese economy, you know, I think Asia is going to lead, and I think China will be at least 1/3 of Asia. Because if you look at Asia in the historical way, you have Japan, probably makes up 1/3 of the economy. You have Korea plus maybe Taiwan as the next thing, and India, Korea, India, Taiwan, probably in that cluster, and then you have China. So China will at least be 1/3. But what's fascinating for me is in the VR and AR world, China has really leapfrogged into the rest of the world. The investments in China is no less than what's the investment in Silicon Valley right now. Yeah, so that's why I said all the guys who are entrepreneurs in US have all came Beijing, Shanghai in one way or form in the last 3 to 6 months. Why? Because they need funding. It's as simple as that. And Silicon Valley is less risk, is more risk averse at this point in time. So it's interesting. So for me, and the other thing is that what's the other fascinating thing about China in the last 9 months has been any stock market, any stock company, and any company that's listed in the stock market in China that got themselves slapped with a VR thing, they are PE roast. It's crazy. I've never seen it anywhere in the world, but it happened. That's why in the last 6 months, literally every company, a construction company, whatever, there was a joke, even a cement mixer company that's listed in the Chinese stock exchange, they want to get themselves VR. Because then their PE can become from 10 to 100. It's crazy. But that was what happened, and of course the stock exchange came in and stopped them. But because of that thing, in the last 6 months, the understanding and the awareness of virtual reality in China, it's fascinating. You can walk on the street. I was in a shopping mall, sitting down having my lunch, and you know, two old folks just beside me, and they're talking virtual reality. I was, wow, cool. Can you imagine? They're talking virtual reality because they say, which virtual reality stock should I buy? No, but it sounds crazy for a technologist, but it helps. It helps us propagate our cause, right? So the point here is the awareness in China is very huge. There's a huge adoption. Most of the B2B companies that I've seen are all putting some kind of virtual reality concept or experiment behind their projects. And it brings me back to 30 plus years ago. When 30 plus years ago, when there was a thing called internet, when you say, I'm internet ready, what's the first thing you did? Do you remember? What's the first thing you did? You say, I'm internet ready.
Yeah,
there you go. You create a website. You use, at the time, Microsoft front page and do www.abc.com. And you raise your hand and says, I'm internet ready. I'm an internet company. Right? That's what we did, right? That's what the old days. So likewise, I think VR is going to be the same. I think when the traditional companies, the brick and mortar companies, the even some of the old internet companies, as they think about reinventing themselves to be VR, they will need to have a VR experiment or experience. So you could do projects for these companies and make them VR. That's why Alibaba came out with a Buy Plus video. It's really cool. You know, you can do internet shopping on virtual reality. And by the way, Alibaba has a huge strategic footprint on VR because they have now invested into Magic Leap. They're sitting on, Mr. Chui is sitting on the board of Magic Leap. And so they're using Magic Leap as AR technology to try to bring online shopping. They're going to reinvent the entire e-commerce experience. So where's Amazon is going to play in that role? Where's all the e-commerce website going to play in Singapore on that role? So these are things that you need to be aware of. So if that's the first thing you can do, go find one company and give them a VR experience. I think there's a room for you in the long term. So anyway, so that's just something to think about. And of course, we think that, by the way, this is not from me, this is from Digital Capital. The CAGR for China is going to be 100%+. And with the stock market, probably more. So, and this is too much names to go through. So as you can imagine, when you have 2015, the turnover, I'm not talking investments, I'm talking turnover. The turnover from China was close to about 200 to 300 million RMB. It's unbelievable because, you know, VR was such a new thing. How did so many companies make money? The first wave of companies that make money were those people who provided the arcade experience. So they created a lot of, you know, they call it the egg-like experience where you put in all the arcades, all the Takashimaya and all the Ion they can think of, and you have consumers paying close to about 30 RMB to 40 RMB for a 20 minutes experience. And it was almost roller coasters, right? It was terrible. The HTC guys scream and yell at it. They say, you're destroying the VR market. But guess what? 200-300 million RMB turnover last year. So this year, my estimate is going to be at least 20 times of that revenue because everyone is now on stream. HTC has sold a lot of machines. Oculus is not in China. So there will be the Chinese Oculus and there will be a lot of discounts. So you can see that you have the Chinese Oculus. And I don't mean it in a bad way, right? I mean, you know what I'm saying. So the HMDs are coming in. You have the user input. Noitem right now is a 2.4 billion company. I saw them when they were 10 people. And G Wearables, I was at their launch. They are also trying to compete in the sensing. So I think if you have, so just another tip, if you are sitting in some university and you're doing some research and you have some technology, I would encourage you to think about how you can take what you are researching, that technology, and see you can have ways by which you integrate into, say for example, a virtual reality or augmented reality space. So if you look at some of these companies, they've all been around some time. I mean, most of them have been doing some things in the, I call it, in focus in a particular way. And they took it, they package it, and they say it's a VR company. And of course, then, you know, in a new era, there's more potential and there's more imagination space for investors too. So this is something for you to think about. Reality capture. So this is where you have the Gear 360 from Samsung. We just ran a training in Shanghai on Jaunt and Nokia. So there was about 100 people who came. We trained them on Jaunt and on Nokia. So I'm working very closely with SMG, Shanghai Media Group, and they just invested in Jaunt. So we are helping them land in China as well. So And so some software, some of these guys, they claim to do some Android enhancements, and that was before Daydream announcement, so I'm curious to see how they're going to evolve themselves after Daydream. Of course, games, video, real estate, I mentioned this, and some of the other applications, and of course online, and some of the platforms. So these are some of the companies that's out there, so go ahead.
We were having Chinese players trying to take on HoloLens.
I have not seen that. But I've seen HoloLens list of components. So somebody in the soft has really stripped everything apart and see the components. So, but I've not seen someone creating the next HoloLens. Any other question? So anyway, just a guide in reference for you, if you're thinking of engaging with Chinese, if you want your for example, when your content is coming out, the first place I would say, get it on a Gear, get it on Steam, get it on PS, and at the same time, look at a few Chinese players to get it in the Chinese market to test the market, to test the contents as well. So this one you can read, I mean, there's lots of articles online. So for example, what's the potential? This is really interesting. So this came out, I think, in, if I'm not wrong, January, February. And I personally look at these numbers and I think, well, this is very conservative. Like I say, they think that the core users is like a million. And then those who have experienced it, that's not really in it, is 1.7. And about 280 million potential. So it's, for me, this numbers is probably old. I think my numbers is higher than this, but of course, I wouldn't quote my numbers. But this numbers is quite valid. So who are the guys that, you know, the first guys who were diving deep into VR? It's 71% male, and that's probably the configuration in this room right now too. And 63%, you know, age between, sorry, this, there's a number here, there's a 24, it's 25 to 34, it's not 13. So, and then 53% of them are, they call it indoor-based guys. So guys who play games and don't interact. I fear for my son, but yeah, close enough. Yeah. So, and what do they like? And also, viewing, test drive, home decor. So these are, this is a survey out of, I think, a sample base of 150 people that they took on the streets. So they just sample the guys, they just ask questions. And then what is important for them, you know, the experience itself, the comfort, and the reality factor. So anyway, again, more numbers for you to just think about as you do your scope of what you're building. Now, when I think about VR, why do I get involved in investments? Because I think, number one, content is great. But if you think about what the technology can bring, imagine today in the real world, for me to take a person in the real world and bring this person into a virtual world and makes it so real that he doesn't realize that he's in a virtual world. Think about how much technology there is involved. HMD is only the first step. HMD only touches the eyes. Make sense? It only helps you visualize, but it doesn't help you with the other factors. For a human to get into the virtual world, there's at least about 38 components in the virtual bodies. So there is a neural, there is the sense, there's a ear, hearing, there's a smell, there is the haptics, there's the motion. And if you look at most of the contents today, they don't have legs, right? So what does it tell you? It tells you that there's a lot more room for this industry to evolve. Today we are at 1.0, some call it 0.5, but we are at the beginning of a journey. And that's what makes it interesting. Because when you're at the beginning of a long enough journey, there's room for you. So if you're 25, you just graduated, you can be in this industry for quite some time. If you're 65, then maybe it's time to retire. But you know what I'm saying. But it's a long enough journey, and it's enough room for you to grow yourself into. And so for me, when I look at companies or entrepreneurs, what do I look for? I look for games, and in games, I have this map where, you know, every single genre, I think there will be some genre that will take off more than the others, right? Just like Avatar is a genre, it's a sci-fi in the 3D space, right? Angry Birds was a genre that totally was simple enough, and it uses the touch. It's so simple, and it just touch. So likewise, there will be some games that will take off in the VR space. There will be a B2B space. We spoke about this just now in each particular vertical. And then Cortec, I look for things that, for example, what sort of things do you do? Do you have the research background? Do you have your friends who is a research background? that has the technology that can take that enabler into the 38 elements of human being into the virtual world. So I look at video, right? So we've done some video filming before. We've done one with CG. We took the Van Gogh art, we put it into a virtual world. We partner with Huawei, it's a Chinese company on that. And we have done, we ran a video competition. We have now 1,250 submissions from China. So there's at least, I counted at least 300 teams in China that's doing video filming, 360 video filming. So likewise, it's interesting. So when you do film, I mean, Mark, you showed me something really interesting. How do you take video in video? How do you take video integrate with CG? How do you take video integrate with the real world? So those are all technologies that you can integrate, and there's a lot of room for improvement there. And of course, if you have a compression technology, then you could be a very big thing, because right now the file size is way too big for any decoders in the browser. So huge space there. Now, notice I didn't mention platform. Platform will come, but so far I see no indication that it will come yet, right? So remember, there's a step-by-step in the whole industry evolution. There's, you gotta have a first iPhone, then you have to have your Angry Birds, and then you can have your, you know, Supercell connected free-to-play online games. And then you can have your next Uber. So it takes time, and the basis for a platform is that there must be enough users. So a lot of entrepreneurs come to me and says, hey, I want to be a platform. And I want to think of Steam. Gateway didn't become Steam straight away, right? They first did one game. Half-Life, right? Half-Life, is it right? Right? So, look, he first had Half-Life, and Half-Life was so successful, and then all his friends came to him and says, can you download? He had CDN all around the world, and then all his friends came to say, can I use your CDN? And then it became Steam. So a platform requires you to have user base before you become a platform, because the investors love to hear stories. Oh, how can you become a platform? That's one thing, but the question then is, why is it there's only one Facebook, right? It's not that easy to become a platform company. So platform requires a user base, and right now, when there's so few headsets out there, for you to be a platform, then you have to be in there for the long haul. You have to be prepared for the loneliness cycle in between. So think about what you want to do. Either you shoot for the Hail Mary, or you go for step-by-steps and try to get there as you evolve the business model. So something for you to think about. So, okay, way overshot, but maybe a quick one. So our vision is to make virtual reality a reality. I support our community, I support our investments. We have an accelerator in Shanghai too. It's about 2,000 square meter, I think. So it's a space where we bring people together just like what you have here. And so this is our team. So Fiona used to run ads. She launched the first iPod 1 in China. And Kevin, some of you have you played Eve Gunjack? Eve Gunjack is the top selling game on Gear VR right now. Still number one, I just saw 2 days ago. And so he's a producer, so he joined our team from CCP. And now we're coaching and guiding teams that we invested in to develop. Jackie was the first guy who wrote a Unity 5 book in China, so I wrote him in as well. So you can see, we come with a disparate backgrounds to help coach teams as we invest in them. So this is something for you to, if you love to be in China, we would love to welcome you in October 13 and 14. I have a vision, right? I said that Asia would potentially be the launchpad of new technology for the next wave. And so I look at GDC as a conference. GDC is very much for games developers. And I hope that, you know, in one form, some way or form, we bring together creators. Because we call the term creators because it's not just developers anymore. It is video filming guys. It is B2B guys. It's new tech guys. So we hope to bring together the world creators together in Shanghai. I'm partnering with SMG. SMG is the big company that owns, it's like the MediaCorp in China, MediaCorp and Straits Time in China, and they own the Oriental Pearl Tower in Shanghai. So we are bringing together a conference. In fact, some of the attendees, some of the speakers we have are quite cool. Hopefully, Hilmer can join us from ECEO for CCP. I have Tim Sweeney. He said yes, at least. Yeah, I need to check with secretary again. But Tim Sweeney from I think I ran out of battery. So, it's okay. If you can hear me at the back. So Tim says he's coming from Epic, and then David should be coming. David Helgeson, founder from Unity. So we also have a couple of actor and Hollywood producers that's coming as well. So hopefully we can bring together a group that can share. It's 32 sessions, and just keep that date in mind if you want to visit China in the autumn. So, and then our fund strategy, I spoke about how we invest, contents call, we focus on the global reach and global presence. So we talk about value adding, how we can value add as a potential investors. And of course, we help our companies exit as well, because of course, right? That's how we make money. So some of the partners that we sign deals with, we are also strategic partners with Google, Leap, and Hive, and Intel in China. And so hopefully we can take some of these partnerships to Singapore too. So with that, that's all I have. If you're looking for funding, invest at UCCVR. If you just want to say hi, hello at UCCVR. If you have a WeChat, by any chance, UCCVR AR is the code. And so just keep that in mind. And then that's my email, alan@uccvr.com. So feel free to engage. Thank you very much.
A Q&A session. So, anyone got any question? Do ask up. You just speak up, lah. I think you guys can hear. All right.
We'll pass the mic to you. Any question?
I just want to know. What's the Chinese term for AR and VR?
Chinese name for VR is called 虚拟现实. So, 虚拟 is virtual, 现实 is reality. So that's VR. And AR, they call it 增强现实. So augmented reality. 增强 means enhance. So,
previously you have mentioned you also had another called MR. So what does MR stand for?
So it's a really interesting thing, because I personally think the analyst comes up with these new terms, or the journalist comes up with these new terms. So MR stands for mixed reality. So for example, if you use a Samsung Gear today, you can shut down everything and you can be in a virtual world, right? Yeah, so you're virtual, that's virtual reality. And you can turn on the camera. You know, all phones have a camera at the back. So you can turn it on and you can see what's outside. So with the augmented reality, you can interlace your real environment with virtual things in between. So they think that, you know, you can design an experience where you have virtual. You can shut off, shut down, and shut off the world and open the world as you need it. So that's what I call it, mixed reality.
With the announcement of Google, they only push Samsung Gear aside, even that they are much more bigger than Samsung.
Samsung and Google always have a love-hate relationship. I'm not sure anyone of you from Samsung or Google here, but you know, when Samsung last year, 2 years ago, they started supporting another platform. What is that platform called again? Titan? Is it Titan? So, because Samsung is such a big component of Android, and so Samsung tried to support their own OS too. So, yeah, so I don't know how it's going to work out. I think Samsung has done a lot of hard work in terms of getting the whole footprint and the technology breakthrough. There's a team of about 250 people sitting in Samsung right now working on this problem. And Google has a much smaller footprint working on Daydream. So what is interesting for me is Google is taking a lot of what they've said and creating standards. And because of the rest of the manufacturers that is not as committed to the cost as Samsung is, they can leverage off a lot of what Google does and translate it. But of course, having said that, if you look at all the cell phone manufacturers in the world, I believe 5 out of 7 of the largest are all in China. 5 out of 6 or 7 are all in China. So, and Google Play is not in China, right? Because they choose not to be in China. And so I don't quite know what is going to be the negotiations and result. Because I'm sure Google would want to be in China again, so they now have a Google Play team that's trying to help developers get out of China and go to international. But I'm sure behind their back of mind, they have always asked themselves, why can't I have Google Play in China back again? So it'll be interesting how the whole commercial negotiation works out. But technology-wise, really it's not that hard. Like I said, you know, that the device itself is not that hard. If you look at Gear, VR, the biggest part is the gyroscope, right? One of the things is the gyroscope. The gyroscope itself there is, I can't remember, is it high-tech gyroscope? So most of the cell phone manufacturers in the next batch, the high-end phones, I'm not talking about the low-end ones, the high-end ones, they are putting in the next version of gyroscopes. So a cell phone is going to have quite a good, decent gyroscopes in there. So that's one thing. So having a gyroscope supports is great. Number two is input-output. Gear tracked with this input-output, so this tap, and for some of you, Gear VR is a tapping thing here. It's not a fantastic experience. So, you know, that one button or three button switch from Daydream is going to be another trial for that. So I'm not so sure how it's going to work out. So we'll see.
Other gyroscopes based on the optics?
The gyroscope, I believe it is. I need to check. I need to check. I don't have it on this. Sorry.
You should show your generosity. What in the chat? You're talking about the missing link right now. Maybe we are beyond the mission. You didn't mention about the tech element.
Do you see that it is forthcoming? The disruptive element will be from the MR, or will it be outside the MR element? Do you think that it's going to be very much already in your scope or in your vision, or it is still not there yet?
I think, so for first thing, I think that the So a few things, just to, it's a big question, but I'm just giving a few points there. I think that for gamers, I think PS is going to educate a big part of the market. There's about 40 million install base right now on PlayStation. Out of the 40 million, I know for a fact the Sony team is planning for about 1.5 million shipments this year, but because they are shipping in October, so they only have 3 months window. Next year, the numbers should be in the range of 4 to 5 million. And so the following year, it'll be more. So I think $399, I think it's a low enough price for consumers who already have a PlayStation to buy it. So that, I think, will educate a big part of the market. The second part where we're educating the consumers market will be the cell phone manufacturers. Like I mentioned, today I can buy a cell phone, high-end cell phone, and I can, for $25 or $20 more of cost, the cell phone manufacturers can get that, you know, that device, the plastic cardboard, to the hands of consumers. I think that would be a big jump in terms of the number of people getting access to that experience. So I think the first thing to do is that as many of the consumers have to have access to the hardware to make a difference. So that's point number one. Point number two, I think in the industry, it's going to make a difference because, like I said, the visualization impact of a new technology that helps the traditional industries reinvent itself. I think that will make a difference too. Now, so business and consumers, that's how I see the thing going along. As for how soon, that's anybody's guess.
Okay, further to that, then what you see in the element, the momentum at Alibaba and Tencent have got to be in the making that you think that we can look forward to their kind of initiative that you think that is forthcoming?
You know, that's the best part. Tencent and Alibaba is not investing in VR in a big way. Simple reason. I mean, I know the Tencent leadership team pretty well. And so, for example, Colin, who runs the biggest game studio in Tencent, think about his, and we're talking about this, think about his pressure. He has to deliver, 9 billion RMB revenue a year to the shareholders. That's his job, right? He's the president of that studio. He needs to deliver 9 billion RMB revenue a year to his shareholders. He's not going to have time dabbling with VR stuff. So he has a team of 10 people, 15 people. Just, you know, he has all the hardware you think about. They're trying stuff, but they're not putting things in a big way. Because the numbers, the revenue impact for these big companies is just too small for impact, which is great. Because if they are all in this in a big way, then they wouldn't, all of us would be working for them. Right? So because they are not in a big way, so it leaves rooms for entrepreneurs and people with ideas and the courage to try stuff and do stuff before those guys come in and hopefully acquire us, you know, in some ways. So.
Lastly, if you don't mind, what about your style? Yeah, what would be your strategy?
So my strategy is to, like I said, it's simple. Gather as many people with talent and passion as possible, give them enough funding so that they will be hopefully, and help them along the way so that they are successful. And if one of you becomes Supercell, I will retire in Sentosa.
Can I have any questions?
You mentioned about the third firewall about the Chinese passport, right? Just now you mentioned.
Yes, go ahead.
Realistically speaking, other than getting a Chinese partner, that's one. Is there any other way that we can try to penetrate into like Chinese market?
Great question. In the mobile space, in the mobile gaming space, a lot of companies came to me and asked me the same question. And honestly, other than Supercell, I have not seen any other company that has been successful in China, in the content side. In the gaming side, sorry, to be more specific, in the mobile gaming side. Because if you look at what is needed, because, you know, and this is from somebody who has been there 11 years, even now, I don't quite know how a Chinese thinks, or a Chinese in the third tier city or fourth tier city thinks. It's very different. I mean, I'll give you one simple example, which is, it has been a story that I've been telling for a long time. The head of Baidu in the past told me this story. I was with him, we were having a drink, and he was texting, and we were chatting. So, this particular gamer, they call him the whale, because it's a big paying gamer. And this particular gamer, this whale, you know, he wanted his character in his game to have fully clothed with gold. He wants his character to not wear any color. He wants everything to be gold. The spear, the costume, the headset, everything gold. And so this, my friend, he has been telling his guys, his artists, and he has a team of two people that did 2 days, do nothing but customize his entire character to gold. So that's what he did. And guess what? How much this guy paid to do that? It's a 2 days artwork, right? For most of us. He paid 20 million RMB for that.
What?
Okay? So that's my point. You and I would never understand that market. Right? So, first of all, I don't have 20 million. Second of all, even if I have, I wouldn't pay for it. So, but that's my point. You and I would never, number one, there's probably like 2,000 to 3,000 whales in China. It sounds funny, but the biggest gaming company in China, Tencent and all that, they're working off a very small group of people. When you do game design, and this is years of working with these guys, when we do game design in the West, we try to be as fair as possible. Because if you're not fair, no one will play your game. True? But that's not true in China. Because if you're fair, the whale won't play your game. So you only want the whale to play and get everyone else to accompany the whale to play. That in itself is a totally different design factor. So everything that you design, everything you plan for, it's going to be so different. It cannot be the same. Because your job is to service 5 people, 10 people. And you have 1 million people or 20 million people to help 20 people. It's a very different concept. So I for one, especially if you are doing games, I would say, you know, it's very different. You have to stay there for some long enough time. You need to have a producer. You need to have a monetization partner that's strong enough that can coach you through that process. You can have a fun, great game. You can make money from ads, right? There's still ads that you can make money from. But in terms of pure monetization from ARPU and DAU, it's very, very hard. It's a culture there. So anyway, but having said that, Supercell has proven that wrong too. So that's why I said, other than Supercell, I've not seen a strong enough team that monetize at that level, and then at the same time, have a good enough tech that transcends firewall. So that's why I say Supercell is a remarkable country. Okay, hopefully that gives you a sense. Yep.
How do you foresee the VR landscape to change the way industry works, like Industry 4.0, the smart factories, or aerospace world? Because a lot of it today and in the near future is some focus on the gaming side. So how do you see VR changing the sort of industry, manufacturing industry?
So for one thing, I was talking to some guys in air logistics the other day. Now, it's really interesting. First thing first, if you look at Singapore is trying to reinvent itself to be an aviation hub, right? For Asia, for the world. And so if you look at the aviation technologies today, the simulator, all the flight simulators that all these guys are doing, and the machine simulation that these guys are doing, if you just go ask them, how much do you pay for that simulation machine? It's going to be tens of millions of dollars. It's huge. It's not a cheap machine. I know this because I work with the engineering universities in China for quite a few of them. And they paid a lot of money for a flight simulator, MRT training, you know, they call it subway, the metro system training systems. And they paid a lot of money for it. Like I said, if you can create a solution, one-tenth the price, one-tenth the time, you will change the industry. So if there's a hint, I think along that way, if you can take the visualization context of what VR can bring, if you can take the connected context of what internet can bring, there's a big change, potential change to that industry itself. That's my thinking. I could be wrong.
Very difficult to convince those people. They still believe that they need a big machine. You make money with a big machine, but you think that, you know, you can get it cheaper, you can address a larger audience, blah, blah, blah. Just not happening.
I fully understand. Because industry simulation has been around for many, many years. Many, many years. Dassault, for example, and all that has been around for a long, long time. So I agree. I totally agree. So again, for every Angry Birds, there's tens of thousands of Angry Birds that didn't make it happen. So the question is, what is that? You got, from a product development point of view, keep tuning it, keep finding it. I mean, you leverage internet as a big thing, as a connected thing, and then leverage the visualization. If you use a HTC versus the existing machines, that in itself, the cost is a big factor. But the problem with most of the vertical industries, it's, I don't know about Singapore, but at least in China, relationships is more important than everything else. So it's who you know and the people you know versus what, you know, the technology itself. So I totally understand, but from a technology's point of view, we can only persevere. If we, like I said, if we say we continuously be lower cost, faster time, and we keep pounding on it, and we have a better experience, a better connected experience, hopefully we'll make some breakthrough. So that's my, at least based on my view in the last 20 years, that's how we have pushed x86 machines. I remember when we were pushing x86 servers into financial institutions, it was always a no-no. Right? Oh, mainframe is the best, and Unix is the best. What? Intel? That's, but look at today. So I just persevere.
I got a quick question. So are you guys planning to come to Singapore to start something like that for UCCVR? And then another question is, if any one of us planning to start a virtual reality company, maybe in China, what's our plan?
That's a trick question, by the way, but I would love to be here more often. So I would, we haven't had any plans, to be honest. Honestly, this is already a summer holidays. Like I said, this was I was coming for summer holidays, and Jiang Kuo says, hey, let's do an event together, let's do a meetup, and that's how it happened. So there's really no formal plans. But again, like I said, I built on a common philosophy and a belief that, you know, talent comes from everywhere. So like I said, you know, I've invested in two US companies now, one Singapore company. So I would love to be investing in talent worldwide. So that doesn't stop us from where we are. In terms of community, love to do more joint activities together. And then if we can have some facilitations of talents where you guys can go to China and see what's happening there for some time, and the exchange program sort of thing, I would love to explore ideas like that. So investments-wise, no problem. Just send me your plans. If we have a great chemistry, love to help in any way. And then number two, feel free to join our community. Unfortunately, my team is all Chinese right now. We don't even have a Facebook page. So that's the first thing we need to do, is get a Facebook page up. So love to explore. So that's one thing, the first question. The second of all is, if you want to set up a Chinese company, it really depends on what you want to do. Right? So for me, setting up a company is just the end result of an idea. Setting up a company or bringing together a group of people is just the end result of an idea. So I think let's start off with a great idea. And let's see what's the unique value proposition. Because always keep in mind, as an investor, when I look at teams, it's always great idea. Then the number two questions is always the toughest to answer. Why you? right? Why? Why is this team going to make a difference? So that's the hardest thing to answer. So if you have a great idea, if you have a good understanding of why you are different, and really focuses on why you're different, then I'd love to engage in anyway. Sorry.
Do you think Unity will provide more support for VR?
Both Unity and Unreal, it's actually going VR in a huge way. So when I was speaking with Tim, when he was in Shanghai recently, he was telling me he has a big team focusing on VR. Now there's a VR editor in Unreal. And then for Unity, I think 5.2.1, in the recent update, there's at least, I think, 30 enhancements in the VR scenarios. So both companies are focusing on VR in a huge way. There's another company to look out for. It's called MaxPlay. MaxPlay is set up by, actually, it's an incubated project from Technicolor, the French, you know, the film company. So Technicolor incubated this company. The CEO now is called Sinjin. Sinjin and his team are all super experienced. The CTO is from BioWare, ex-BioWare. And so that team has done quite a phenomenal job in terms of rendering in a VR world too. So keep a lookout for that. It's called MaxPlay. You can just check out maxplay.io, I believe, is the website. So check it out. So there's a these companies are going to provide a huge VR support for in terms of VR support for the developers.
Hi. Once again, we'd like to thank Alan for taking his time off his summer holiday to come down to talk to us. We're going to take a